match that you have not sent in a match report for and do not have a confirmation email for, do it tonight, because we're going to start invoicing teams, and once we invoice someone, if you haven't done a match report, you're not going to get paid for it going forward. So I think most people have done all of them, but if you haven't, do them now. New payment system, electronic payments seem to be working. I've gotten one question about it, but otherwise people seem happy. If you want to switch from it to paper checks, or if you're on paper checks and want to switch to it, just come let me know, and it's easy to switch around. And then, if there's anyone in here who hasn't given me their social security number, I think everyone in here has, do that before I will send you money. Some, I don't know, interesting numbers, if people care. This season, we've earned roughly $27,000 in revenue. We'll pay out, so far, about $15,000 in referee stipends, another $27,000 for mileage, and another...
$2,700
for mileage. Numbers aren't really my thing.
Reality.
And then, just over $1,100 in travel and flights and hotels and stuff like that. Wow.
So what you're saying is you're going to be banking about $8,000 for just spring?
Well, yes and no. So we have a pretty large expense this spring, which has been all the new kit. So that's been kind of an odd purchase for us. But yeah, so without the kit, we would be banking... that's probably pretty close to what it'll turn out to be. With the kit, we'll probably end up spending somewhere around $12,000 in kit, and that will give us, I don't know, $3,000, $3,500 in credit at RA Rugby, which either they could pay us it, or give us a check for, or we can use towards new stuff that we want.
Here with these shorts.
We need some shorts. And some cool sunglasses with something neat on the lens. Questions?
Great guys.
Love the payment system.
Scheduling. Not a whole lot to report here. I do want to thank everybody for keeping up with availability. So far in the spring, I think we ended up, we've got 267 matches or so on the books. Much 98% of all matches, maybe only one or two that weather, things like that, that didn't get covered. So all good there. We do have three people here who are going to be busy this weekend. Would like to introduce referees for the Rugby Colorado Division Finals. D2 third place, referee John Kenny, ARs Anthony Nguyen and Kevin Perry. Doing the D1 third place here in the stadium on Saturday, Mr. Dave Fellows. We'll have Ryan Haggerty and Mark Huff for assistant referees. The Division 2 final, also here in the stadium, Mr. Steve Gore. Greg Wolf and Kevin Berry. And taking the D1 final, the same game we started the season with, Mr. Eric Gaia. D1 final. Tom Hiddler and Chris Huff. So that is our appointments. Jim Bruce, you're number 4 for the D1 and D2 games. And let's see, and Mike for Eric, PR, and Joe for Steve. They won't be able to make it. That's it, guys. So, congratulations. Who's up?
That's kind of development.
play rugby, which will have 12 attendees, and 8 of them are sponsored by USA Rugby, so I can, they'll be kind of zone camps, but we're calling them referee continuing education camps. They'll be June 23rd and 24th in Sacramento, and then like August 30th in Philadelphia. There are 4 open spots that people can apply if you have the financial wherewithal to get yourself there and to pay for the hotel and the meals and whatnot, or if you have your LROs or TROs or Sugar Mama's financial backing to get yourself there. My suggestion is everyone who's serious about their refereeing, apply. All the high performance management group, all we can do is say no. And if we get enough applicants, you know...
Can you also say yes?
We can also say yes. The worst we can do is also say no. Sorry. The worst thing we can do is also say no. So I don't know how many people are on the USA Rugby Referees Facebook page, if you're a whole number or not. But it's kind of on there. It's under, if you just search under Kurt Weaver, it's on there as well. And then it's a job form. If you need to send it out to you, I can send it out, shoot me an email, send you the job form to apply. My way to
send it to you.
Yeah, well, like Gilligan, yeah, you should have sent it out to Reddit. That's good. That's funneling you down. You should have all received it, by the way. So, I will like to congratulate. There are 2 members of Armor that USA will be paying for, and that's Chris Huff and Nick Tricarico. So, they're not here, but. Nick will be going to the Philly camp, and Nick and Chris will be going to the Sacramento camp. So.
Good. Keep them apart.
Yeah. For sure. Probably Chicago doesn't be north south on probably soon. Maybe not. So Jim Bruce.
Sorry, hey, just on that, if you guys do apply and get accepted to it and financials are a problem, let's talk, because this is like off of that.
In addition, Racking on Rugby, they're pretty good at helping out, getting grants. All you have to do is fill out the paperwork and then submit it, and they're good about it, union.
I will suggest when you apply to actually put some thought into it. I'm getting applications or like, yeah, I like rugby, I want to be a better referee. I mean, you know, think of it like this is an investment into your cause. Write a decent, make it a problem for me not to accept you, or the group to not accept you. Like, holy shit, we gotta get in here. And then, like I said, there's also Kickstarter you can do, raise your own money, if accepted. It will be announcing like May 15th or 20th. I forgot. So we'll announce who gets the other 4 spots. With that, Jim Bruce, high school.
First of all, so we wrapped up the 8th, 9th, 10th grade festivals down at Colorado Springs, and once again, thank you guys. It was great. Most of the festivals we had, I think there were 5 of them, we had more than enough referees where the refs only got 1 game. Again, no pay for that, and I really appreciate the support we got. The only time we were a little tight was down in the Springs, which we thought we would be. And Joe Zevin filled in at the last minute, decided he'd make the trek down there. I really appreciate that. Also had Paul Pettit, Mark Musselman, and I took a couple games apiece and got that taken care of. The other probably big development so far this year is that putting together the agreement with Rocky Mountain Referees and Rugby Colorado. We're getting signatures on it now. And it's been relatively painless. This is about the 4th one I've done in the last 10 years. And most of them have been gnashing of teeth and, you know, lots of swearing and threatening to, you know, start our own society.
Why are you looking at me?
What's looking at you, Joe? But,
let me hear you.
As I say, this year it's been an absolute dream. I thank Steve. He put a lot of work into it ahead of time, and it made it a whole lot easier to get through. The other thing I'd like to talk about is the red-yellow cards. Last year we had, I think, 50 yellows, and most of those came from the high school boys. This year we're at 24. We had 16 red cards last year. Red cards were major incidents that would have qualified as a red card that came before the disciplinary committee. 7 of those were either clubs that had been misbehaving or coaches. One coach was given a, actually two coaches were given a year suspension last year. They both resigned. This year we've had a grand total of four red cards, and nothing on any of the coaches or clubs. So it does look like things are improving rather dramatically. I don't know if this is a blip or if it's a big turnaround. Also have a lot of really good feedback on the referees. One thing I haven't noticed is in any of the match reports, there's a box in there for coach sideline behavior. And we haven't got any comments on that at all this year, so I don't know if you guys haven't filled it out or for some reason it's getting left out. But if you do have any comments on anything going on the sideline or any issues with the coaches, it's not so much that the disciplinary committee is going to see that and go give them hell, but we do look for trends the same way when I look at the coaches' match reports and they grade referees. You know, you see some referee that will go A-A-D, A-A-A, that, you know, we do nothing. If we keep seeing the same thing, that a referee is constantly being rated a D because he's not getting to the breakdown or because of some other thing, then I'd obviously get back with this group and talk about it a little bit. But again, we saw very little of that last year and none this year because nobody's filled any of it out. So if you guys do have an issue with a coach or with sideline behavior, we'd rather get it and try to nip it in the bud rather than wait till it's a real issue at the end of the season. But generally, I just think it's gone great, and I really appreciate all the support. So thank you.
And we're only doing one match report now. Right?
Yeah. Is it just the rugby
Colorado? Yeah, so I don't think that's an option on the
well,
rugby.
Well, the rugby Colorado, I'm
just the Rocky Mountain Rugby report now. But
well,
it goes to, if it's a rugby Colorado match, it goes to a different group of people.
But if it's the Rocky Mountain, it doesn't have anything for coach or sideline either?
No.
Okay, well, I guess I pulled up the...
There's a comment scene.
There's comments, which
field set
as for technical zones and field set up.
There's also a picture report.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there any way to include that if we've got issues going on?
Can you do it for next season?
If you would. I think
it's competitive, so they fall
it really worked well last year because when we did have a problem and had to go see a coach, it was nice to be able to say, you know, we've sort of seen this building all year. And you know,
I mean, Eric, any issue we shouldn't do it from the union side?
Hold on.
Sideline behavior?
He wasn't listening.
Oh, sorry. He's like,
trying to get in my match report.
Provo didn't show up this weekend, so it was great.
They didn't?
They said they were coming down.
Yep. Which is why I was told to not go.
I know, I understand that. More on that as
well. Before we drift off on it, in past years, the report that's been filled out for Rugby Colorado has an area in there for coach bench sideline incidents.
So I guess the only trick there is that people have complained that there's already too many lines on the match report, whereas I don't think it picks that up.
Field should be
well, there's things on there that's redundant, like kickoff time and action. Because, you know, okay, I get it.
Yeah, it's just like the...
I think that's on there because, in theory, somebody would pull a report at the end of the year and go, like, guys, and just...
Yeah, so like one team that keeps changing their thing, probably a catch-all somewhere else.
Well, like both times I've ref Northside, they've forgotten to contact me, and then the opponent gave me the kickoff time, and both times that kickoff time got pushed back. So, like, that's a good example of a club that could maybe use a little more hands-on management of, hey, guys, what's going on here?
Yeah, maybe like was the kickoff time scheduled differently? Click this box and write it from it.
Yeah.
You know, sure.
Or just a general common area to cover it all instead of all these little...
Well, yeah, but then...
But that's how you sort of catch everybody.
People who don't come
so like at our... for the union side at the AGM this year, I sat there and nailed every single person who hadn't had a scoreboard yet because we said that's a new policy. That kind of stuff.
But in general, we haven't had any anecdotal stuff that coaches on the sidelines have.
I don't have any.
Do
you have any issues? I think I kind of overheard Kurt saying that, you know, technical zones will be what the... I think we've done it this, we've kind of bought into it, kind of not bought into it. I reffed a high school game that they didn't have ropes. So, I mean...
just say one thing from the semifinals this weekend. Boy, they adhered to it beautifully.
That worked great. Yeah. Everybody knew right what to do.
It was fantastic.
Yeah.
So I mean, perfect. Just don't be the guy who, like me, who doesn't like adhere to it just because I wanted the game or safety or whatever. So yeah, that's going to be mandated probably next competitive boys, probably for the women's too. I can't speak for that because Chris is here. So you'd be here soon. Welcome.
Excuse me.
New cameraman. It's Jeff, right?
Yeah, Jeff. Yeah,
yeah, great.
Thank you. I guess anecdotally, so
well, that's good. I haven't been in, but there are issues. It'd be nice to see.
There has been, though, there was some issues in the match where because they're in the box, he gives them a little bit more.
The only thing I have heard is several complaints about the injunction.
Yeah, that's an issue that we worked on, executive committee. That's definitely an interesting topic. Say that. So if you do, go up for injunction and that's something we'd like to know about, I'm sure. They're kind of on our watch list. We've tried to resolve some stuff.
However, the CMU field was fantastic. The E-Nexus
field,
like, marked out, and the team, the CMU guys, and the golf girls have done a great job.
It's the new field.
Putting it all together. Rick, you could attest to it. It was a nice field around.
Gary, it was very cold.
32 degrees. But hopefully that'll.
Yeah, that's definitely an opportunity for us to expand. And, ideally, we'd like to have some tournaments down there and support them and get an education class and an L1 out there and kind of bring them in. That would really help us out. Easier to send down me or Derek or like a referee who can coach a little bit, coach seven of them and train them up, and then they can watch these online, get them part of our society.
Do we have an L1 schedule out there?
There's been rumors.
The one Haggerty took was out there, so that was probably
that was a long time ago. But there's been noise about it recently, and every time I talk to Doug, is it?
Yeah.
Every time I talk to Doug, he says, oh yeah, we've got a dozen people or something, and okay, call me. Send me an email. Let's get this going in official channels.
The other thing with Grand Junction is whatever our long-term strategy is for Utah, it's a lot easier for Utah refs to get there than it is for us because they don't have the mountains to do it.
Utah Rugby.
I'm just saying, it's 4.5 either way for both, but they don't have to go through the mountains, so if it's inclement weather, they can still get there.
Yeah. I still think it's probably in our best interest to initiate that L1.
Agreed.
Probably.
There's just not
as a society and cut the team off at the pass and, make sure that we are the referee society here in Colorado and let's show some leadership and, help ourselves out by getting referees out of Aspen to defiance, the Grand Junction high school teams as opposed to waiting until the end to fight for people to send out there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, okay, Kurt Beaver's not here, he will be here. So, anybody watch the... We'll go to open forum a little later when Kirk gets back. Did anybody watch the Varsity Cup final? One person? Okay. What were your thoughts, particularly on the scrums?
In terms of bouncing the Cal 3 out, or penalizing him, or...
Well, yeah, okay, that's where it goes.
Trying to
in the second half.
Yeah.
I mean...
Trying to remember in terms of the scrum specifically. They seemed fine for a while, then they deteriorated where the new guys came in or some subs came in. I'm not quite sure where that one guy came from in terms of the guy who was a problem.
So, I mean, I was one of the ARs for it, and it was actually on my side. And Kurt had a big, long development list for what he wanted to take care of. But right away on the first scrum, I kind of noticed that is going to be an issue all day. And the reason why I knew it was going to be an issue all day, Kurt said, I kind of have an issue with some guy angling in. And I go, well, this is the reason why, in my opinion. And it's because, basically, I have some pictures of stuff. And you let me know if you're happy with these bindings. If you can get a tight head binding on the back, more on the back than he does, and you get your loose head longer, the boring, the popping up, a lot of that will go away. I swear to you that I'm not lying to you about this. Just get the binding right on this, and your issues will most likely go away, unless you have some really dominant pack and a really guy who wants to cheat. But there's a photographer just taking snaps and snaps and snaps. And I had him just, every time there's a scrum, could you just take a picture of the binding and then just kind of snap and see what happens to it. So we're just going to kind of review this. And Kurt, I told Kurt this, and he didn't. He said, oh, okay, I'll take a look at it. But I really stressed, like, get this fixed. It's an issue. It's going to be an issue. It turned out to be an issue because three got done twice, and then Cal was smart enough to sub him. A new guy came on and bowed on the back, and it was fine. But, yeah.
Just as a note, there was another game that Kurt and I watched that was on TV or whatever. It was that one Cal BC game.
Yeah.
And
same guy. Yep. And Kurt said it had an issue.
Yeah.
And I'm not lying to Derek to test this. I mean, if you get this binding right, a lot of your nightmares of scrums are going to go away. I promise you that. So we'll just kind of run through some images. They're not in any, well, I guess there are in some order. So, again, you're gonna get this a lot at a higher level. This is not ideal. Ideally, I'd like him over here. Or at least up here. And this binding from the loose head looks pretty good. You know, it's as long as he can get. If we just scroll through, we'll advance to the next one.
Why is the referee wearing khakis?
Oh, that's in warm-ups.
Thanks, Mike.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. He just sent me a bunch of stuff, so let's see if... So, the initial setup, it was kind of similar to that.
So, sorry, that's fine.
No, I'm sorry. So, this is basically what would come after the engage, and that's the ball's in. He would grab his shirt long, but his shirt is untucked and loose, so it looks like he's doing it, and there's plenty of shots. But eventually, like, his shirt would just come down, and he'd just have leverage on it. The black loose head started long too, but as soon as set came, it just came to right here. So basically you have your loose head's elbows down, and then he's in a kind of controlling issue. And then you have the tight head's elbow shortened down and down, and he's applying pressure on that loose head, causing instability.
The thing that's weird about it, though, he did a couple times on his own put-in. In fact, when he got penalized,
yeah.
It was on his own ball, which was crazy.
It was like a reset. I called it in. He didn't understand the call. He went over on that side, and then penalized it. And because
yeah. Why the guy was doing it on his own ball?
Yeah. It's just bad. Well, I'm not gonna say it's bad technique, but it's the game within the game, and they've been doing it all day. So let's just kind of take a look at some more stuff here. Again, this is when he starts to take him in now. So he's starting to take the loose head in with him. And I've never propped, but I can't imagine you use a lot of your strength in your arm for stability. And once that's taken away, and this arm's around your hooker, are you just using your back and hips and legs?
Yes.
Those are
strong,
core.
Strong.
That is a nightmare.
And wow. This short arm by the loose head actually has a purpose, not just lazy. Yeah. If you can push in on the ribs, that destabilizes the tight head.
Also get your scapula back when your arm's
on. And if you think about it, it's you can bind long But it's almost impossible to keep it that long as you engage. Yeah, these loose heads shorten it a little more. You know, their timing is such that, oh, the referee says, oh, he's just coming in.
So, again, it started long, it's on set, and he just pulled it down because his jersey's tight. So, ideally, why can't he get it here? I get him there. The guy's hands are in the way, but I still get him to bind right there. And I don't have any issues. Like, right over that guy's hand. It's not a big deal. I've had prep players do it.
Yeah. Oh, no, they can't keep, so they just can keep their arms
don't
straight.
Be compliant. Absolutely. And Kurt was that, yeah, it was a long bind. Well, it was a long bind in the wrong spot.
Okay.
I mean, I have, yeah, so there's some better ones than those.
Yeah. Because, the loose guy's going in, man, flanker's able to kick out and block the scrum.
Well, again, so there's a really short bind by the loose head. The black, his arm is on it. Both elbows are down.
Both elbows are down.
They were rarely very strong props, and they only had like one collapse. It was on. White 3 took it down in the first half. The ball was in the back. Kurt got it out, and then there was two more collapses. One I sent in, he didn't use, and then he came over. He collapsed again, and he got penalized twice, and then got subbed. The other guy bound on the back. It wasn't an issue.
Post bind, post engage, making sure that tight head elbow is up is pretty key too.
Yeah, I mean it's just that's on the side. That's not on the back. And really, like up here where the number one is, like right there, that's not very great either. I mean, there's no reason why he can't bind right there. There's some good setup ones. And I don't know how this doesn't go down. I think I remember watching this guy like bends down and
put
saves
his head it. In his butt.
Yeah.
How low it is.
Like, how the hell is that not going to go down?
Core.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, core. And then everybody's standing.
So, again, here's the setup. They are low, but he bound a long bind, and this is right set. There's some ones like pre engaged. And right straight down. Fix it, Kurt. But you know, ultimately it's his game. I mean, when this kind of thing is occurring to you a lot, it should be like a red flag. Like, oh, that's not good. Maybe his argument is, well, the scrums didn't go down too much. They broke, don't fix it. And it is a pressured game.
How many collapses were there?
Three.
Three all game?
Well, three that I was cognizant of.
Okay. The other times you were looking up in the stands in the future?
No. I mean, this is an intense game. I'm not going to lie. This is probably one of the best assignments you can get as a national rusher.
Sure.
If not top two, top three. this is when he started taking pictures of the free stuff. Yeah.
But to me,
there's a lot to this game, and you didn't have three collapses. It's just a teaching point. Like, this is a red flag. If you have collapses, this is probably why.
Absolutely.
So the usual game I had this happen in the number three would start to stand up to counteract being boarded in.
Maybe, yeah.
Yeah. He'd drop his hips and stand them up. The ball was coming out, and it was only that.
Threes don't stand up.
The three was standing out?
Threes don't stand up.
The threes get driven.
Well, that's what was happening. He was coming up out, right? So I tried to get, because his hips weren't kicking out. So we got some more guy to go back in, that big snowy game down there, Carl Springs. I was just happy.
Okay, so again, like, you think, these are long binds. This is, I've got it done, right? Great.
He can't see either of those binds, can he?
Yeah, but this is how the setup is every time.
But isn't that kind of the point, right? Like, from where he is, you want to see.
He's looking right at where the. I can see a hand up here.
Can you see that hand?
Yeah.
Certainly can't see
this one.
The loose head's hand.
No, I can't.
Okay, you can't
the
see
biggest it. Thing I'm concerned about is tight end. Because, again, like, binding here, loose head's not going to be able to bind up any higher.
No, he's doing the best he can.
He's doing the best he can.
Tight end is close.
And ultimately, he's going to take it short, and this is going to go in, and it's going to be a. It's just a shit show.
But, like, I can see the tight end bind back here. And there's no reason why he can't bind right here. There's no reason. And that, trust me, just try it.
And if he does mark, the loose hit can bind up.
The loose hit will bind higher.
Yeah.
No, you were bad when you spot on, Mark. The tight head should be on the back.
But this was the standard all day.
And when they come together, that elbow should stay up.
The way they're going to come together, this is going to be short, he's going to bring it in, and it's going to come right down.
You need to hook the arm. Tight head should hook the arm.
That was the bind. This is the set. Pulls the shirt down. This guy brings it in close. It'd be great if he kept his elbow up the whole time, but he's not going to. And this guy's... Just look at the arch in his back. He's not in a position of power. Tight end was leaning on him.
You can see from the relative feet positions.
Well, and his head way below his hips.
He's not hinging for sure, but I mean, loose head is definitely getting dominated right here. That one's not too bad, that binding on that tight end. That's okay, great. I think he knows that he's got the loose head right now and he's not going to take him in. The binding on the loose head is not great at all. This will be a new scrum. Also, this is the second half. This is the second half. Because the other guys are on that side now. That's great from the loose head right there. That's a long bind. That's all right.
Elbows are up.
Yeah, that's all right.
I think so.
Different props. See, it's high enough and it's not long on his shirt that you can get a loose head to get some good leverage there. Yeah, that's not great, but...
Elbows are up.
Yeah. Loose head. There's no way the tight end's going to take that down. If anything, now the loose head's coming in on him.
Loose head's legs are straightening up. And
yeah,
he's going to come in on him.
But... And if the tight end extended his arm and actually bound back here, you can't really hold him out, but you can try to hold him out and keep him straight a little bit. Yeah, so it was a trend. It didn't go away, and it caused two penalties, three collapses. It wasn't major thing. I mean, this is really big boy rugby, but I'm just saying, if you're having collapses, go back and review your film and see if you're getting that proper bind, like on the back, like right here, you know, instead of here, you know. So, let's talk about this tournament we like so much coming up in September. We kind of got some preliminary numbers of what we're going to send up there. And with the size of the tournament, this is all very preliminary, but the guy wanted a count of how many we're going to do. So we're probably going to send 10 speed. It's very similar to like last year. 10 referees, 12 ARs. Who will, these guys will most likely ref on Thursday, and some on Friday, and help out here and there. And then we're gonna do probably 6 coaches / PRs. So it's kind of tight for numbers for sure, because 3 of these are gone for exchanges. And 1 of these is gone for the national PR. So just kind of what can you do to make yourself one of these guys? Make it a problem for the selection committee or executive committee to, you know, like, oh, we have to have Jim Bramley up there. He's made every meeting. He's done, his fitness has improved. He's gotten X amount of the law tests. He, whatever, he contributes. He's coaches. He does whatever, does the match reports. You know, like, it's now kind of a selection process now. And we've kind of established that for, like, the last 2 years. I wish we had the money. And if they had the biggest tournament that we could have everyone come up. It's just not like that anymore. I am still going to try and get the $60 a night rate. If you want to come up and, you know, bend an elbow with us. You never know. You never know if someone gets sick, whatever, we need someone in the AR. But ideally, for sure, I'd like to have everyone up there. But for the selection, this is looking like the numbers.
About so 2 fields, right?
It is going back to the full-size tournament. He says it's going to be, you know, bigger than the World Cup, but that's what they always say. And it is a World Cup year, so it definitely hurts the numbers of the old boys coming, because they're going to go to England and play in the tour and watch Tonga play Samoa, whatever. We do have a couple scallywags coming in. I think Leah's has an open invitation for now on. And since our magistrate retired, we'll probably be bringing in one of these spots a new magistrate. So that's interesting. Regarding kit, I've asked you guys last October to start coming with sponsorships and financiary. It sounds like this guy might buy us our kit. I doubt it, but he kind of was wondering about that. But still, let's still get some guys to get our kit. And what are we going to be this year? I've had no ideas of fun jerseys we can have for Aspen.
Clear.
Lumberjack. Mr. Rainer,
I'd say Marvels. Yeah.
Marvels.
Avengers, for sure.
Avengers?
Do it.
It's tough. It's tough because I got to get 4 jerseys.
Just do the flip with
Iron Man. Iron Man, Captain America,
and
Wonder Woman.
Now you go DC and Marvel, so all the nerds are going to freak out.
Superman. Batman and Superman.
Superman.
Joe?
Once again, folks, really think that we should design a jersey, and I'd love to serve on the committee, design a jersey that we can wear somewhere other than 2015 Aspen Rugby Fest.
I would wear that.
Well, Steve wears his in Vegas, and I've seen.
I definitely wore the tuxedo in Vegas.
That was very popular.
Plastered on.
Yeah, somebody sent me a video clip. Bunch of guys standing around. Girl says, "Nice jersey, nice jersey, nice jersey."
Well, that was
nice
2 years ago. That was.
And then goes to the lumberjack and says, "What the hell is that thing?"
That's because Steve was wearing it.
Burn that shirt. That's what she said. Because it was so great.
Yeah, I hear that. I understand that. We do have 4 rumor armor jerseys in stock, you know, so I'm not against it, but let's just go with what it is. I mean, obviously. So, Batman, Superman, I actually thought about that. That'd be good too. And then, anything else? Think about it. Send me emails.
Wallace and Gromit.
Jeez. Too obscure? Have a Costello for you, Joe, maybe? What was the name of that actor in that talkie movie one time?
All
right, so again,
think about it. Let's get this going because I gotta get basically an order in June if we want them. And we're not freaking out because
they're stuck in customs.
Because they're stuck in customs because we ordered it in August. All right. Well, let me text Kurt Weaver.
He left the office at 3 o'clock today.
He had
a
meeting with
someone.
Oh, open forum.
Hey, Rick, should we ask that question?
No.
Ask the question. Whatever it is.
Now you're
back. No, it wasn't Rick's. It was my issue, but do you want to go first?
Can I go first?
Go ahead.
So I'd just like to acknowledge the work of the referee coaches this year in the season. I haven't had too many sort of assigned, but I can tell you one thing for myself is that when everyone has been assigned, I've gotten a lot of benefit from it.
Yeah.
And I appreciate all the time that those guys have put in, Joe and Mike, and for the rest of the time.
Yeah, very good. I am working on getting more referee coaches. There are some guys that kind of faded away. And I also would like to not transition some people into referee coaches, but have some people start becoming referee coaches as well. So we have a guy like Craig Tarr, who's a tremendous guy. I'm trying to get become a referee coach. Why wouldn't he be? He can't referee anymore, his back's hurt, but come on out. Guy like Greg Wolf, who's still a pretty good referee, but let's get him transition.
Okay,
Dave, someone like you as well. You know, Mark, take the course.
No.
It's not a judgment on anything, but there is rumor of like this technical college kind of starting.
Where's that?
Next fall, every person will be applied. They'll all be level 1, level 2, match official certified. So there could be 40 people, 80 people. That will be either vying to play for NFL, and some will cut it, but they'll all be certified. So we just basically increased potential referee pool by X amount of students. And that's going to be huge. So that is a huge influx of youth, knowledgeable referees. And that's, I've always said that I want it to be pretty hard to get a match assignment here. Like, because you have to show up for the fitness test, you have to do so good on the law test, you have to come to these meetings, you have to be an active participant, and it should be an honor to get a match here, especially in the stadium, especially for some of the high-level stuff. I mean, there is some, we don't have the D1 stuff like NorCal has. We don't have the coaching that NorCal has either, but I've seen some of their support staff and some of their society. We are definitely a society or membership or whatever Kurt wants to call it, because we don't want to be elitist, that we support each other and we have tremendous development opportunities. Stu, from the now 4 national panel guys are gone every weekend, there's some really good games that Stu and Steve and Rick, and I have gotten, Chris, there's some really good games, and you're like, holy shit, this is rapidly advancing. And guys like Joe and Mike, Jim, coaching. Joe has been just a godsend for the coaching and PRs. He's been out there every weekend just giving great stuff. But we should have a coach for everyone. You know, we only have 3 coaches kind of with radios. NorCal has 10. Let's start recruiting coaches, as well. Same thing with referees. So, still need some young guys, still need some young guys. Megan's new. Jeff's new. Welcome.
Thank you.
Next meeting, bring 2 people.
Alright, let's talk.
Yeah.
Oh, one issue. So this will be fine.
What
so,
I
know. What's that?
What I actually
know. Yeah,
maybe.
Let's
you want to be the ball here?
Let's
do it. So, this happened to me. Saturday, Park City versus Boulder. So here's the situation. Park City's attacking in red, okay, Boulder in white. So red kicks ahead into end goal. Okay. Blue, red and blue chase. Okay.
Red and white. You mean red and white?
Sorry, red and white.
So Park City.
Boulder's blue okay. Sometimes.
They are.
You go with it, yeah.
Oh my god.
So Park City and Boulder both chase. Boulder player collects the ball, goes to ground, rolls onto his back, and flings the ball over his shoulder into overtouching the goal line.
Dead ball?
Touching goal. But, what's your decision?
White player threw it out. Who
white,
brought it
hang
in?
Hang on, hang on. Kicked in by red.
Brought in by red.
Kicked in by red. Okay. White, boulder player, collects it in goal. Okay. Rolls onto his back and flips it over, touching goal. All
right, who had their head up?
Intentional.
Thank you.
Head up, head up. See what your answer is.
I'd say it's player picks it up. Is that boulder?
Boulder.
Boulder.
It's knock on in goal.
Let's go through the room.
So
everyone's quiet.
From the attack 5 meters.
Wasn't
okay, well that's his answer.
That's what it is.
His answer is scrum 5, red ball. Jim?
I'd say 22.
22 meter dropout.
Say so intentionally threw it out as a penalty.
Okay, so what's your sanction?
The whole thing.
Where?
Where?
Where at?
Penalty to who and where?
Penalty, so holding committed penalty.
Cry, please.
So penalty to whatever club that is, where team was.
Park City.
City.
Where's the mark?
And the mark is going to be on the 5 meter line.
15 meters.
Okay. Quiet. Let's everyone have their answer. And
penalty try yellow card.
Penalty try yellow card.
No.
That's depending on whether it's intentional. If it was not intentional, then it's 22 drop. If it was intentional, then your thing. And it says.
Potentially. Yeah.
If it was intentional,
okay.
Then the penalty would be.
Penalty 2 5 meter.
Penalty 5 meter up?
No, I think change possession, boulder, put it out intentional, it's going to be try.
Okay.
If it's intentional, then it's a penalty try.
Penalty try?
Yeah, I wouldn't have done a penalty try. I would have done a penalty.
Penalty 5 out?
Yeah.
Unless the laws change, penalty try.
Penalty try.
I don't know
penalty
5 out, but
it's
not. Penalty 5 out? It would only be a penalty try if Park City would have scored.
No, I'm pretty sure it says a penalty try must be if it's a touching goal.
Okay, well, hold on, this is not the debate. Let's just,
no, it's
not
debate.
It's not a shit answer. So let's figure it out. So you're saying penalty try, Joe?
No, I'm saying 5.
Penalty 5 out.
Penalty 5, cross from the spot where the ball went into in goal, where it crossed the goal.
Yeah, okay.
Goal whatever you already know.
So I was with Stu on that day.
Okay,
yes.
So,
I
Jeff,
what did you call?
Hold on, Jeff.
I'm trying to remember it.
You were right there.
I was right there, I know,
oh,
I know.
Oh,
yes,
see your help.
Okay, so basically,
Mark, what do you think?
Kirk.
Was it intentional?
He wasn't there for us, Mayor.
Kelly tried.
I would probably go penalty where it crossed the line and yellow card to the boulder player. Oh. And then if I would have gone penalty try, I would have to. It was there a Park City player. Like within close proximity of scoring that try. If you take out the boulder player, completely eliminate him, shoot him with a disintegrating ray, would a Park City, what's the word? It's
probably
yeah.
Scored that try. So again, like if I'm Park City and he's boulder and I'm going to do it, he does it, and I was like, right here, there's no one around me, I would score the try, penalty try. But if there's another boulder guy there, a couple boulder guys, Park City's not close, came from a kick, so. Penalty cover. My thing is penalty 5 across the line, yellow card.
So what I ended up doing was penalty to Park City, 5 meters from the goal line, but 5 meters from touch.
5 by 5.
I didn't think the boulder player had clearly gained possession of the ball in goal and was on the ground when he. So all he had to do was literally.
Yeah, why, what was he trying to accomplish?
So I didn't feel that.
Maybe he didn't know where it was.
So I didn't feel that it was worth. So I didn't feel it was worth a penalty try because, in my mind, it wasn't probable that because he had possession of it when he threw it. It was not probable that Boulder would have scored. I'm sorry, that Parker would have scored a try there if I had taken him out of the equation because otherwise the ball wouldn't have been there at all. And so.
Well, so but if he was not never there, he never would have collected it.
But he did collect it. It wasn't exactly foul play, high tackle, 5 meters out.
Well, throwing the ball in the touch intentionally foul play?
But he had it collected already.
Yeah.
Is that a
Eric's
definition?
Eric's foaming at the mouth.
I was going to say, it's actually in foul play.
10.2C.
Yeah, 10.2C. A penalty try must be awarded if the defense prevents a try that would properly have otherwise been scored.
We'll read the rest of the first half.
That's letter of the law, guys. Come on. This is an elastic
game. I like that. I did a penalty try.
The other thing here is, like,
player must not intentionally, it's just that the player must not intentionally knock.
Do I there create any sort of flow in the game by awarding that penalty a try?
You're gonna get one team really pissed off.
It is. But
player attitude is a referee problem.
His possession is stupidity.
Let's start with the law. So the law says it's a penalty.
If otherwise, for yeah.
What if Park Shirley otherwise scored that and taken that guy out of it? He just didn't exist.
If we just take him away, he's gone. That's a try.
Okay.
Right. I mean, I guess that's what I was going
to. That's what
we had the benefit of actually seeing it, or we actually saw it. It's fresh in our minds. I mean, it's not like he was like two guys contesting for the ball. He ripped it away. He was clearly separated from the Utah guy.
Yes.
He clearly had possession. He clearly just had to do this.
He's just an idiot.
Chucked
it
out. There was this contested moment.
He's just for a second. 4 meters in, he's going to put it behind.
So I'm not saying there is a correct answer to this.
Right, yeah.
But there is a
reasonable.
Well, there's a series of answers.
Yeah.
So obviously, it's a penalty kick. Where it crossed the line, 5 meters out, no closer than 5 meters, right? So that's within law. That's
actually, so let's correct that.
That's the minimum.
Yeah, it should have been 15 meters in because it occurred in goal within 10 meters.
Well, it should have been no closer than 15 meters.
If it was taken in the middle of the thing.
It was taken in on the corner.
It's so, in the corner, he didn't have that.
So, no closer than 15 and 5.
Yeah, 15.
Closer touch line than 15 and 5. Two, penalty try, and yellow card. So that.
So there's a checklist.
Well, yeah, so there is. So, the very least you should do, penalty kick, no closer than 15 to 5. Yeah?
Right.
You can go, and here is penalty kick, admonishment, caution, and then penalty try, and then penalty try, yellow card. Basically, in this kind of point, if you're doing a penalty try, it pretty much needs to be a yellow card. I know it says in the game management guidelines you don't have to, but that's kind of, so that's the end of it. Jim?
But it does sound to me like this was clearly stupid rather than malicious.
Stupid should hurt.
What's that?
Stupid should hurt?
Yeah, but it does hurt. I mean, instead of getting the 22 dropout, there's a penalty against him, 5 meters out. That's huge hurt. That's giant hurt. I would have trouble doing a penalty try and a yellow card if some guy just dumb picks it up and flips it over his shoulder to go up. The admonishment, sure. The penalty, sure. But I would have trouble with the yellow card.
I mean, Glendale lost 10-7, 2 years ago now, because they threw the ball into touch and Summers rightly awarded the penalty and then the Barbos went down and scored.
So
stupid hurts.
Yeah. Well, that would hurt a lot to go from a 22 dropout.
A rule rugby, again, like, shit goes downhill. A World Rugby Sevens manager just harps on us, clear and obvious. You all hear that. Now he's starting to come into, and you hear Kurt, me, Derek, Zapp say, that foul play, make it a player's problem. It's not on the referee. You're not being a bad referee because you did it. It's he committed foul play, and it's on him. So, I mean, I'm just saying, that's foul play, that's a player's problem. That's coming down from the top. It depends on what kind of referee you want to be. I'm not saying there's a right answer, there's not a wrong answer. You can, by all means, penalty. You know, sorry, hey, we'll try to do that next time. High school game? Yeah, sure. Chaparral is getting beat by East 100-0, and East, you know, Chaparral does that. All right, listen, you know, whatever. You're doing Fiji Samoa, maybe you're going to think about a penalty try. Again, this is a playoff game for national implications. It should be refereed like they're going to be refereed when they go to the playoffs. There's a lot of mitigating factors. There's not a right answer. It's just what kind of referee do you want to be? What are the stakes? What's the game like?
Are you helping guys out later? Are you creating issues for guys later if you don't? You know, those are all kinds of things. Like, refereeing, it's hard work. And it ain't easy, but everyone would do it. But that's,
I can't. I mean, he definitely landed on the ground. He's laying on his back. Literally, all he has to do is tap it. He just goes.
My first reaction was, what the hell?
And that was as I blow my whistle,
of all the options, what the hell?
It's got to be intentional.
That's why I asked. It was definitely.
Okay, so if it was an intentional, then there's no question.
Through the law, we've got curiosity at Park City score off the penalty.
Park City score off.
Yes? Yes.
Yes.
And what did that do to the outcome of the game?
It didn't. They already had a 2-try lead. And they won by 2 tries.
Yeah, well, you shouldn't sleep at night.
Management question. Let's say you do decide to do the penalty kick. And Park City is very aware of what the law is, and they come to contest it to you before they actually tap it. What would you do?
What's the code to our door? 624.
624. No, but just like out of curiosity, let's say you decide you made it a lenient call, and they are immediately aware that you made a lenient call.
Yeah.
Like, what would you do as top of road?
If they come to me and say that's got to be a penalty try, so I don't think so. I don't think it was clear and obvious enough for me to do that.
Yep.
No one's going to... 10-2A! You know, no one's going to know that. I mean,
see.
Whatever. I don't even do that. I would just... It wasn't clear and obvious to me that there was intent to throw that out. You just got to sell it. You don't sell a steak, you sell a sizzle. That's what it is, you know? Yeah. I mean...
I don't even know if I'm remembering exactly, because he just hit the ground and it just popped like that. So I didn't know if he literally, intentionally threw it, if it just bounced off, but it sure looked.
So it's a...
But
you had to decide.
But I had to decide, so I stopped. I asked Jeff.
No, because if it wasn't intentional, the problem is what you thought. It's a big difference.
Yeah, exactly.
22 versus the defending side. There's a penalty to the attacking side. So he gets a big swing.
Yeah,
he just fell back.
They got horses dead.
Yep.
It'd be great. Bartok. Who else had issues?
Not an issue, but open forum.
Open forum.
To say that. So thanks to Kurt for organizing the semifinals of the high school playoffs. I think it set a good platform for the whole thing. And I know all the work. I think every game had 3 referees, if not 4 for the upper division one, so that was awesome. And I think it really shows where Colorado, that the society is there to support it.
Let's definitely build on that.
The other side of that is that starting May 23rd, and then 2 weeks after that, every Saturday, the tribe will have tons of games for anyone to come referee. And really, it's the upper division. If you can come early and watch the younger kids do the lower level kids, it'd be fantastic, sort of help coach them. And then once we use the U13 above, U13 and U16, those are regular rules rugby, minus no lifting, but so 7s are on smaller fields, so it's not that much work to do U games. It'd be great to have people come out and do it.
When we have
the dates and location, I'll send them out to the group. Starts May 23rd, and it's 2 locations, north and south. It'll be every Saturday for 6 weeks. The last week is at the Denver 7s on the 2nd, in pot over.
It was north and south each week.
North, yes, and
in
south.
The south and
that's a great start. All right, so there's basically 12 events, right? Do so you take the Denver 7s out of it, because anyone who will be there will be hands on deck. So there's 11 events. Can you commit, everyone in this room, commit to making one event? Everyone?
Yes.
Get to one. Get to 11, great, but everyone get to one. Is that right? Okay.
It's actually a lot of fun. I do it every year.
I'm
kids
sure
are free. Parents are free.
I've never been to one. I'm guilty.
Yes. When would they start and how long was
so
it going for?
That age typically starts around noon. So once you get to that level, the kids actually start in the morning at 10. So we usually have our younger junior
10
referees.
Is the first kickoff.
Yeah, junior referees refereeing the under 8s, under 10s, under 11s, under 12s.
And guess as to what time of the afternoon it's over.
That's over by 2.
Finish by 2. I think if the girls are playing that weekend, you might finish by 2:30 or 3.
Mm-hmm. If it didn't rain in
4 hours on a Saturday,
But what a great training ground for a referee.
And recruiting ground for a referee, Eric.
I said May 23rd is also college sevens.
Yeah. Okay, so all right, so you have basically 9 events to. Yeah, Paul will send it out. Send it out to the group. And when I get it, I'll commit it back out saying, guys, let's commit to everyone making one of these steps for these days. Yeah?
It's also, for anyone who's thinking about coaching referees, it's a great opportunity to go out there and watch, you know, the high school kids do young level refereeing and be able to talk to them and give them some pointers. And anyone in this room can go out and help these kids and give them some advice.
And it's just an adult to support them and make sure that, hey, look, don't worry about those coaches being jerks. I'm your adult here, I'm gonna help you out, referee, you know, make me crap. I got your back. And really it's, you know, hey, keep up the play. Be better if you kind of came in this angle at the breakdown. It's a very simple thing that the kids are working on. You know, 3 key things, and you helped. You made it. You made a better referee for the next week or the next season. So.
Yeah, participation does not go unnoticed by the NCAA.
Yeah, I'm saying. There you go. Tick the box, bro. How many boxes do you have to tick? Make an issue for us not to select you. Like, well, you know, make a problem. Anything else? Are we related, gentlemen?
Did we get that? Did we get the hand off to the face thing figured out?
Move to a chair.
It was so. The good news is, Rugby Colorado, I was just at their board meeting before this, said they will absolutely have technical zones in every match going forward, even regular season matches. So they were sold on that weekend, so it's a good thing for us. Everyone.
The sweet water jerseys?
Sweetwater jerseys. Yes, yes. So I'm going to run through. I actually did this to do it last month, and I apologize if I did not make last month's meeting, but I wanted to share a little bit about my trip to South Africa. It was an amazing experience for me, and I learned a whole lot about refereeing and also just rugby in general. But then I also got to meet a bunch of amazing people due to the downtime that we had and where we ended up staying and the families we were with. It's funny because when Derek Summers precedes you into a country, it's always unique to see how that experience is going to go. It was sort of a comparison, like, oh, either you're like Derek or you're not like Derek, or, you know, it was funny. But each town you went into, is like the scent of Derek was there, so it's good that they remembered him. It's also our mateys, referees that we send down there every year, are over in Stellenbosch. We actually have 2 down there now, Nick Cottrell and Cody Cutsman, so those guys are down there now. I actually just missed them by a day in Cape Town, but we're sort of... the teams that I refereed had not really seen American referees because I think Derek and the Mateys referees stick to most of the school's games, but the surprise in their face when they see an American that's going to referee the match is likely the surprise that maybe our women referees see when you show up to a men's match who's never seen a woman referee. It's just sort of like, this is going to happen, right? Wait, do you know the laws? Have you seen rugby? It's like, okay. So it was a fun experience. So I want to run through just a little bit. I got around the entire country, which was wonderful too, just for, I guess, by benefit of having games in different places. And so I got the first place I went was...
Went to his desktop.
Yeah.
From the grave, he hunted me. Okay. It's all my nifty. Okay, so the first place I went to was in Pretoria, and Pretoria is near Johannesburg at Loftus-Versfeld. Loftus is the stadium there, home of the Bulls. For those of you who watch Super Rugby, it was a great experience. It's sort of, I'd say, the Bulls are one of the oldest clubs there, and likely one of the more steeped in tradition kind of clubs. They have an amazing facility. And the coolest part about it was getting the tour from the nice lady who runs the facility. I just walked in and they're like, oh, it's an American referee. She gave me the entire tour. I got to go through all the locker rooms and I found our friend Andre Simon, who is coach of Glendale here. He was an all-star player there. And when you mention his name there, it's like everybody gets quiet and they're very reverent. He's quite the star and all-star of the entire Bulls organization. They certainly love him there. Got to go to the Bulls Sharks game, which, if those of you who watched it, it was the one where the TMO had some challenges with some forward passes and other things. And it was a new referee's first Super Rugby game. And the TMO had
2 to 3 rough calls with him. And so that referee for the next month just got slaughtered in the press. So it was pretty tough for that referee. But he's a really great referee. He's actually back on Super Rugby now. So next trip was only in there for a couple days before I got shipped off to Kings Park in Durban. Kings Park is the home of the Sharks, which I was kind of centered around the Super Rugby stadiums while I was there. Because of my day job with the youth, I got entered into each one of their rugby unions, so they were very welcoming. I met with all their development people. On this trip, I actually got to go all through the stadium again. John Smith actually was one of the guys that I got to hang out with for a little while. He's the president of the Sharks now, but I got to eat some amazing meat and hang out there. We went out to the townships. Let's see if
there's any colors. Let's go up here.
Thanks.
Right here.
What's that?
Here.
Yeah. Sorry, let me see if I can find it. So we went out to the townships. That was one of the most unique experiences I had. We went out to the townships, or the, you know, really shanty towns. That was amazing to see the kids out there. The schools are just thousands and thousands of kids that have really nothing at all. This is how they use their scrum machine. That was a scrum machine provided by the union, and they now use it to hang their clothes up. They basically deconstructed it. They put up posts at every single school in South Africa as a development thing. All the posts got stolen, taken down for scrap. And so it's funny that they keep trying to develop rugby into the townships, but it's a tough road to hoe for them. So this was the site of my first match, which was kind of a cool thing. After touring the stadium, you get to see all the stuff. Got to go out and actually referee a match. This is a Varsity Shield match. So they have the Varsity Cup, which is basically a Division I of collegiate. Varsity Shield is the Division II. Varsity Cup I could not do because they do the two referees in the field at the same time. Interesting. I got to say, I didn't hate it. On my way over, I was like, that's not for me. I don't think I'm going to like it. After watching, it's an interesting idea. I think it's something that we would potentially want to try to pilot with shadowing, which is instead of just a shadow where you stick next to each other, it's two referees on the field helping each other out in that way. Instead of a traditional shadow, for those of you who have done it, a two referees on either side of the breakdown is a different way to shadow. And so I think maybe not as a professional game on a Saturday thing, but if we could use it as a development tool, it could be a cool thing. Other rule differences and variations were the scrum half, the defensive scrum half cannot compete at the back of scrums. So no niggling offside penalties or jump too early or is the ball in or out, sir, kind of things. It's none of that. So it's actually a great thing. And this is the top collegiate leagues that do these rules. And they try to vary it just to be able to keep the game flowing. You can call Mark from anywhere in the field from a kick. So if I catch the ball midfield, I can call Mark. And it's the same rules as if it was in the 22. As well, if they catch the ball and they don't call Mark, you give a scrum advantage. And if no advantage comes, you go back for the free kick from where they caught the ball, even if they didn't call the mark. So if they didn't call the mark, went took one pass, the guy got smacked, immediately come back for the free kick at the point of the catch of the ball.
What's the thinking behind that?
Just keep the game up and moving. They don't want to stall it with things like that. They don't want people to get caught sort of in the backfield without any kind of support. They want to keep the game up and moving. So it's a...
That's what it sounds like to me.
Are they doing it at both levels or just where they have the two refs?
Both levels. Okay. So the challenge for me was, the first game out this night, I was wildly confused. It actually helped me to calm down in my regular refereeing because the game is very quick. And so I had to think about new things, which made me sort of default to the, you know, reaction brain for the old things, which I think helped me out. Because I would have been probably too focused on, get the tackler out of there, you know, freak me out about it. So it really helped me to focus, and the players were great about it too. They were really helping me out in the field. They're like, that would be an advantage, sir. They're great about it. They picked my pocket a couple times, but they are in the infancy of learning how to have college sports. So they don't have a big tailgate on Saturday before the match. They don't have the whole thing. There's nothing about the American collegiate sport experience that's over there. But they have now started to implement it from rugby. And I almost describe it as the cutest thing. It's almost as if somebody woke up one morning and finally saw college sports, like, hey, let's try it. But they're doing it with no budget, no support or anything. So there's, like, they kind of have cheerleaders, but they're not really cheerleaders. They just hang out there. And then they have Miss Varsity Cup. And then Miss Varsity Cup, they all wear sashes, and they come out for the teams, and they're trying that. And they're having music and DJs. So they're trying to do it. And I think they're going to be on their way quicker than anywhere else trying to do it. So they really see university and Varsity Cup as the future of rugby in South Africa, not so much rely only on the Super 15, because that's kind of a tough thing to get into. They really want the collegiate level because they see the success in America. Tough game. I learned a lot, and it was a great warm-up game for the next one. So So then I got to go to the Sharks Academy. Sharks Academy has 4 full-time referees that live and go to school there. Their academy system links up with the university, so the kids go to university during the day, for part of the day. They then come over and they do academy work with the guy that's walking in the door right there. He runs all the academy sessions. It may be similar to what we're going to get here with some of the plans they have around Glendale, but it was, I think academy to us, for those of you who have been to something that Mark's done or, you know, the big weekends, it's packed full. And I was very surprised. Their stuff is like 2 hours a day, and that's the academy. And so the rest of the day, you're free to work, go to school, do other stuff. But for the referee part of it, it's 2 hours a day, and that's it. So it's not as high of a stringent work environment. Now they'll go train, they'll go do other things, but it was great to learn on that day.
It's 2 hours a day every day.
Actually, no. So some days they'll have off. So it's not even the Mateys Academy that we send those guys down to. The normal group goes there for like 8 weeks to 6 months. And in those times, you're in for one session a day, maybe, and that's it. So they do a much more low-pressure environment in the learning side of it, but they have games almost every day. And so your games are what you're really focusing on each day as part of your development. Townships, again, it was like I said, very eye-opening for me to see that, and it's the development work they're trying to do out there. The most interesting thing that I learned about that before I get... This is the most interesting thing I want to tell you about this. We're talked a lot about women's rugby because they want to know how we do it, because it's something that they don't have there. In the Zulu culture, they have 8 tribes, I think, across South Africa. In the tribal culture, in most of the Zulu culture, in order for a girl to marry a guy, the guy has to go to that girl's dad and basically buy her for cows. And so the girl is worth anywhere between 1 cow to 100 cows. And the cows are legitimate, you have to buy a cow. And the cow is $1,500 US, which is an immense amount of money for them. So the king, the Zulu king's daughters are worth 100 cows. Extrapolate that out. In order to negotiate with the dad, if the girl gets hurt playing rugby, her cow value drops. And so none of the dads want their daughters to play rugby because their cow value would drop and dads would need less cows. So getting girls to play rugby there is not just a thing about, do you want to play the sport of rugby? It's also, if you get a black eye, your value drops and you're not playing the game anymore. So it's a unique challenge they have over there that, you know, it makes our challenges look very small compared to what we have.
The challenge is changing that so that their value goes up.
Well, yeah.
From a rugby injury.
I'll let you fight the battle with the Zulu warriors there. So then I flew back to Johannesburg and Pretoria, and I got to referee the Vodacom Cup match. It was the Friday night TV game. It was faster than anything I've ever seen. Being on the field, it truly was just the absolute quickest thing. The players were amazing. There were 6 Springboks in the field when I refereed, some current on the way in, some 4 on the way out. After looking at the video, the number 6 from the Bulls, is this the Bulls against Falcons in red? After the game, the number 6 from the Bulls came up and he's like, you know, sir, you did a great job. From, you know, didn't know American referees around. He's like, just check the video. I was legal every time. And he went back and he legitimately was. So his poaching was so good and he's so quick to the ball. I had to guess sometimes, like, there's no way anybody could have legally done that. When you check the video, he did. So he was just that good. TMO, I had a TMO and I had a TMO call. And of course, I get over there and I forget to do the stupid TMO sign. So I call up the TMO and the protocol is right, but I forget the TMO sign and everybody made fun of me. The other amazing thing about this was the featured Friday night game, and everybody, including the grandmothers, watches rugby every single time it's on. And so I would go into restaurants or places for the next week, and they're like, oh, you're the American ref. And they all knew who I was, and they had a critique for me on a very specific piece of law that I had either missed or gotten right or wrong. And so I was lucky the commentators were very kind to me, and I think, see, that's one interview was actually legal, and I got up for it. The commentators were great to me, and I was really, really appreciative of what they did. And the players were actually very appreciative as well. I think they were just very surprised there was an American referee. I got a game added to the schedule, which was a schools game. I didn't have any schools games scheduled, but I'm really glad I did. In South Africa, your entire school goes and visits the entire other school. And so you play all of your girls' and boys' sports against the other school all at once. So netball, hockey, rugby is all played the same day against that school. And you only play schools that have the number of teams you have. So if you have an A through E side for your U19s, And then it's high schools or U19s, then it's U16s, U15s, U14s. Each one of those has an A through D or E side. So you only play schools that have the number of teams you have in netball, rugby, and hockey. So there's no real divisions there, just how many teams do you have, and we line up and how we play. This is up in Tabazimbi. All the kids line up, so all the netball, for the final game, there was like 500 kids over here and 500 kids over here that their first teams run through. And so netball and hockey and everything else is done by the time the final game happens. And the entire school is in the stands here, and all the kids out on the field. It's amazing. So I got to do the first side game for the high schools. And those kids they're all probably could have played the varsity cup this weekend or even better. There were four kids on those teams in high school that are contracted pro athletes already with the Bulls. Got to do the varsity shield then. This is the University of Vitz versus the University of Fort Hare. Again, this is the team that they little celebration. It's kind of funny what they do. This is Vitz Varsity Cup, or whatever she's doing there. Yeah.
At least.
Fun game. What I can tell you, the first game I got to referee with the first varsity shield game, Peter DeVilliers was the coach. He used to be the Springbok coach. He's now coaching a college team. It's kind of like our coaches here. Once you finish with your pro thing, it's just, I want to take a break. I just want to coach college. And so he's a college coach. He was wonderful. He's actually now working with the union to see if he can come over and do some work with us. After that, I got to just relax for a day and go see the family I was staying with. This is their kid. And watch this. Kid just gets drunk. It's all barefoot. So this is the U13s, I think, or the U12s. All barefoot, 15 on 15, full contact. And they go all the way down to U8s. Full contact, 15 on 15, full rules. There's no variation at all. At the U8s, there's a couple little variations. But it's all barefoot, and it's wonderful. And again, each school has A through E size for every single grade, and it's just rugby all day long.
Why barefoot?
No worry about cleats stepping on kids, and so you don't have to worry about bodies on the ground. And so it's a safety thing for them. It's also, I think, an advantage. The kid who's bigger and stronger doesn't necessarily have a grip to be able to get into you, and the little faster kid is a little slowed down, so I think it's a normalizing effect. And then the cool thing is once you hit U14s is high school, and so it's U13s is barefoot. When you hit U14s, you add shoes to it, and then when you hit the first side of your school, you add numbers to your jersey. So it's like an honor thing. You add shoes to it, then you add numbers to the jersey. And
I went to St. George School, British Boarding School in Australia, and it was almost identical to that, except in the U12s, U13s, if you got selected to play for a representative side, the school would buy you boots.
Oh, wow.
But otherwise, you played barefooted.
Yeah, and I think it's a very cool thing. We'd never get it through right because my little angel can't play bare feet. So I think that's a problem we have. But I think tennis shoes is a sale for us, and I think we should really harp on tennis shoes as the kids, because it's not an extra cost thing. The kids are going to have tennis shoes of some sort. They don't have to go out and buy cleats for rugby. And I think that's another cost savings for the kids who are playing rugby at that point. Then I got shipped over from Pretoria to Durban, back to Pretoria, Johannesburg. Then I got shipped over to Cape Town. Cape Town is awesome. I gotta say, if you ever are looking for a place to visit, Cape Town is just an amazing place. I got to go to Newlands and meet the players, actually, so I got to do their walkthrough. I also got to see they're the current winners of the Currie Cup. So this is the actual Currie Cup. It's 1894 was the first year it was awarded, and those little badges on there start from 1894. It's amazing. I got to go out and I got to meet Dwayne Vermeulen. He's one of my favorite players right now. He's the 8th in the Stormers and 8th for the Springboks. He's a thick dude. But they're all nice. They're all super nice guys. So got to meet some interesting new friends as I was down there. I took a little road trip the one day on a train down the coast in Cape Town and got to see... So there's a beach down there where there's just penguins hanging out and you can actually swim with them. So you just it's like you get in the beach in the water, but the penguins are just around you. There's South Africa, there's no fences, there's no like cordon them off. So I'm walking back to the train, and you can see the water's down there, and he just walked up. And so he's just hanging out. And so down the beach there must be 50,000 of them. So he's everywhere. And so he saw me coming and hit on the car. As soon as I walked away, he came back on the road and he kept walking. I don't know where he's going. I assume cars are hitting penguins, like it's deer. then I got to be the sideline sideline manager for the Chiefs, because the Chiefs played the Stormers on the one weekend. That was kind of a cool thing. During the video, actually, during the game, you could see me because Sonny Bill got concussion tested, and when he came back in, I had to hold him back from just going into the game, and so they kept coming up with the camera to put "It's all Sonny Bill" over there. So I also got to be in there for their weigh-in. All the Chiefs players weigh themselves in before and after the game. They also piss into a cup for hydration. So they just need to be in the locker rooms and around while they're doing all this kind of stuff.
Did you hold the cup?
I did. I was trying to pitch the Sonny Bill in his panties, but it didn't work out.
Is it always club guys? The golden cup?
Yeah. So this is an interesting experience as well, because seeing a Super Rugby game from that level and just the speed, and this was an amazingly aggressive game. And this is Sam Kane and Aaron Cruden, who are, two badasses.
Who was the referee?
Yucko Piper. So I actually was staying in the hotel with Yucko, and so we had dinner the night before and then breakfast the morning of. And probably one of my most enlightening meetings was I got to sit in with his ARs in his briefing. He probably had 3 pages of written notes for the game. And the minutiae he went down into preparing for games was fascinating. I think you can see as a referee, he's very structured, and you kind of get that, but man, he's an intellectual about the game, and the things he was thinking about, that's the game where the Chiefs didn't compete with a tackle, and they went around the back, and they were just kind of waiting there, and then he ended up blowing them because they approached the nine. He had prepared that, and exactly what he was going to say, and how he was going
to
say it.
So I need to explain this.
Yes, and so he knew, he actually had written out on the paper what he was going to say. So he knew that far into that match of what was going to happen. It was really impressive. And it certainly influenced what I'm now doing in game prep. Other cool thing, when I was in Durban, because Craig Joubert came over in Chicago, got to hang out for a little bit, he told me we played touch for the day. He doesn't really do fitness anymore. He just does touch with his friends. But touch with them is like all-world touch. I think I pulled my hammy twice just during the touch, like trying to keep up with these idiots. So it was fun to be able to meet those kind of guys. Mark Lawrence coached me during my first game. Craig took me to play touch, and then we ended up hanging out with John Smith for a little while. So it's kind of one of those, I was a fangirl for half the trip, just to hang out and scream and yell. The last one was Western Cape versus TUT. This was back over in Cape Town. This is Peter DeVillier's team again, so I had him for the second time. Again, he was great. He was a wonderful host, and took care of me while I was there. And then, of course, Cape Town is just a beautiful, beautiful place. So it was a wonderful trip. I learned a whole lot on and off the field. I brought home books and stacks of development material for the youth stuff, as well as for my refereeing. It certainly made me look at things differently. I think when I came back, the adjustment from those games back to this game, I had a high penalty count the game I came back. And I think looking at why that is the case and what I was looking for on the field, I was certainly adjusting my brain according to what I was doing down there. And when I came back, how I did not make that adjustment here. And so I think that's one of those things where I need to understand differently what the games are that you're going to be given. And certainly it was different. So, yes, sir.
Any idea why the drop off between schools and university? And as far as the.
For us or for them?
For them, their support system, the institutional support.
Oh, yeah, because when 4 of those high school kids are pro athletes already, you just skip by. So it's like NBA for us. The NBA is allowed to get you in high school, or I guess right when you graduate.
Not anymore.
It's
1 year.
You were. But when that's the case, you don't go to college anymore for your sports. You go right to the pro setup. And so they have under 19 and under 20 pro teams for the Bulls. And so you don't go to college if you really want to play rugby.
So
you go to
the
Bulls
setup. Fucking the best school boys.
Yes.
Hockey and baseball.
Hockey, you go play juniors, or you go straight to the NHL.
And so they're feeling that squeeze, though, because they funnel it down so far. So after you graduate high school, you get funneled down so far, there's so few athletes that you actually have a very small depth pool. And so what they wanted to is, that's why the university didn't want to bring it back in, because it expands it back out to having a much greater pool of players. And as we all know, a kid at 18 and a kid at 23 is a different kid for those of them who didn't grow early. So I think they're realizing they're faulty in the system. But there's kids who had pro shoe contracts, pro clothing contracts in high school. 16 years old, 2 years before they graduate, pro shoe contracts, money, monthly stipend from the Bulls. It's crazy. Now, the kid is 6'6", and 240 as a 16-year-old. But yeah, it's a strange setup, for sure. And it made me appreciate the NFL for having their structure in the way that they do, which is, I think it's safer, it's a better structure, it keeps corruption out of it, because it's definitely a corrupt system. They'll go in and buy players at 16 just to stop the other people from buying them.
That's
the problem with the system. So, happy to answer any more questions about it. I think I'm going to give you a quick example. Mark knows what this looks like. It's likely too much, but this was my match prep for the Varsity Cup game that I just had. And I would have never done anything like that before I went down there, because I never looked at the game in the way that I did coming back from that. I'm not saying that length is what you should do in your game prep, but certainly it made me look at things differently. And I think just prepare for the items that you may not overcome. So I just have a quick drill then. I know it was supposed to be one more thing, but it's getting to 8:30, so Gore wants to go and have an adult beverage. I have a quick thing for you, so if you would take one and pass.
What color was the car?
White. A+.
So I'm reading a book, and this book is fascinating to me, and I will certainly share the book with you after I'm done reading. You can have my copy, or if you want to get the copy of your own, and I'll email out the link to the book so you can see what it's like. But it's I hate fiction books. I only read either historical stuff or nonfiction or something that will help me in my life. So I get into some really weird books, but this one has actually been good for me. It's the car. So it's thinking fast and slow. So like I said, I'll set up the link. I'm going to show you a quick video, and then we're going to give you an exercise. So don't look at the paper yet. I want you to watch the video. If you've seen this video before, don't say anything, and just keep the tally on your own and keep quiet about it. If you've not seen it, great. So you will be counting the number of passes. So get ready. Count the number of passes the team in white makes. Not out loud, to yourself.
The answer is 13.
Y'all get 13?
Listen. But did you see the moonwalking bear?
No.
Yeah.
Where?
Totally didn't.
So this exercise is fascinates me, because if you've not seen it before, no one sees the bear. Literally no one sees the bear. Some people say they do, but they actually don't. So I think what I'd ask you to do now is that there's two different systems in your brain, and one of them is going to be basically your reaction to things, that you have a knee-jerk reaction. The other one you have to then take some time to process. And so the example that's easiest given is, if I ask you what 2 + 2 is, off the cuff, you don't even have to think about it, everyone's going to get the right answer. But if I ask you what 48 times 72 is, you all have to stop, and it's basically the engine starts up, and you start to then do the multiplication, you think your way through it. And as I'm trying to apply this to rugby refereeing, I'm not all the way through this book, but it was fascinating to me to think about what is natural and automatic in my rugby refereeing, and what are the things that I have to stop and think about. And I've seen almost everyone in this room referee, including myself, where you blow the whistle, and you can see the wheels turning. Like, it is a physical thing where it's just like, shit, what just happened there? And so then an arm goes out, and then a signal or whatever else it might be. So what I'd ask you to do is, real quickly, down the left-hand side, just list out some things. I've done the first two things for you, scrum feed and tackle release. So scrum feed for me is an automatic thing. It's on reaction. I'm kind of looking at it. I may not even really be looking at it. It's just a natural thing for me. So that falls in my reaction category. But tackle release is something I really need to see, and I need to process it in my brain, and it's a slower item for me, and so it takes more of my brain power to do. So I put it over in the process conclusion side of things. So what I'd ask you to do is list out just things in the game, and you don't have to finish this now, but list out things that happen in the game. Line-out throws. Do you ever watch the line-out throw for the pump? Very few of us do that, right? So that might go on it's in there, but it's not even on either one of those categories. So when you're thinking about it, try to list out some things in the game, and are they reactionary, or are they processed? And what my goal would be as a referee, and what I'm starting to do, is what are my processing items that I need to get bumped over to reactionary? What are things that I need to get put in that reactionary category? And I would argue, and my hypothesis would be after I get through this research, is that better referees have dumped as much over in that reactionary category as they can. And they're only focusing their brain power time on a very few key items. And so you might be focusing your brain power time on hands off the face. But that's a wasted brain power item if tackle is the key thing that you need to be focusing on. Not to poke fun, but that might be the item, right? So if we can move as much as we can over in that reactionary pace and free up our processing time, we're going to be better referees for it. And so I'd ask you to just take a minute here, maybe with your partner next to you, and write down some things, and where does it fall in your category? And is it different than your partner? And I think that's what I'd like to see, is there differences on what's reactionary to us and what's processed. So does that make sense for the exercise? Okay, so take 3 minutes here and write down, just write stuff for the rest of the match. You get all a pen, you're fired. Write more items down with less discussion around them.
Yes. Yep.
Clearly you're using your thinking brain, it's not your reaction brain. Try to get 10 or 15 written down, and then whichever category they'd be in for you. Side of their brain, they would flash up letters right in front of their face, right in their foveal vision, directly in front of them, and then they quiz them later about what letters had flashed up, and they would have no idea that letters were even flashed up in front of them, because they were using their processing brain on the problem at hand. So they put a math problem in front of them and flash up the letter. I think that's the monkey for us. And so the fascinating part for me is, I'll go back to video, and I'll see, I'm looking at it, you can see my eyes, it's looking directly at whatever it is, I know that's wrong. How in the hell do I let that go? Or how did I get that wrong? I went the complete wrong way on a penalty. This is starting to make me think about this, how much of my brain was I using on something else? Was there a player that had just talked to me about something and I'm thinking about it in the back of my mind? Or was there something else going on in that breakdown that I'm completely missing the punch, which I miss punches all the time, amazingly. I can't believe it. But I'm looking at something else and I'm processing it. And so I want to think about here, give me examples, anybody, what currently is sitting in your process side that you would like to get moved over?
Well, let's have a general question in terms of the law's design so that it's malleable, or there's a lot of gray area. So how much can you really turn into that reaction? Because
that's a great question. I think more than we think. Because I think, I would argue, if you all could disagree with me, a lot of the game plays itself. And we probably involve ourselves too much in too much of the game. And so because the laws are written the way they are, the players are 99% compliant, amazingly. They go off the reservation on some things, but I think we are probably too involved in too much. I know I am and still have to work on that every week. Give me an example of something that's currently on your process side that you would like to move to your reaction side. Go ahead.
So, it's a kick that's behind the 22. And the miss is
perfect.
Were they at the lineout, or they happened actually Saturday, because I watched it. I watched them pass the ball back to the 22 and then kick a straight in touch. And I was running the line, and I ran all the way up to where it went out, and then stopped. And
it's a perfect one. Exactly. We're so programmed to go to where the ball went out that's one of those easy ones. So I want the group to think about this, and let's all work on this problem. How would you, or what ideas do you have around taking that item and moving from process into reactionary? How could you drill it? How would you change your current activities? Could you do something in the off days? Do you go to a team's practice and work on it? How would you all fix that problem if it was yours? Go ahead, no, please.
I was just going to say, I've come up with a mark, so because I think a lot of what happens for me is I lose where the 22 is because I'm too focused on the gameplay, and I'm not really focused on where the mark. So as an AR, I come up with a mark is to know, okay, like specific flag post or a person in the crowd, that's where my 22 is, and that's where everything changes in the game, essentially.
Well, I like that, a visual cue outside of the normal line.
Right, because
I
can't
want an additional visual cue to just get right.
Yeah.
I like that a lot.
Yeah.
I kind of answer my own thing. I saw it in a premiership game, the referee was always calling out the 22, you know, behind the 22. Out loud.
Yeah, carry back.
Carry back. And that's my problem, is that I'm trying to keep it inside and not speak it out.
But I like the additional visual cue, a colorful shirt sitting in that in that row, whatever, or a sign on the side of the field.
Yeah.
That's a good one. I like that. Mark, did you have one?
I would just say to yourself or aloud or on your breath, taken back, or give yourself a cue every time the ball is passed behind the 22 from a defending team. Just say to yourself, taken back, or sometimes you announce it, taken back, so they know that they're.
Yeah, I think.
But that's something that probably as ARs we don't do. We let the middle referee do that. I think that's something in our own brain. Maybe it's just a little bit, just taken back, just to remind us, not even for the players. I like that.
Rick?
I mean, that's literally what I did to kind of fix that part of the game for me. I mean, I thought that 100% fixed it, but I missed that a couple times in matches, and I watched you guys, and you guys almost always say it out loud, whether you know it or not. It's not necessarily for the players. I was like, nobody could have heard that.
That came from, I didn't know that I was consciously doing this chart, but
yeah,
it came from that exact thing, which is, I screwed it up too many times, I have to fix it. How do I fix it? This is how I fix it.
Well, I started doing it as an AR too, and that was, you know, for me, what I would say, like, brought in, you know, just for me anyway, that just saying it, like, you know,
like that.
Even if I start going to where it was kicked out, like that, it reminds me, oh wait, I just said brought in.
So who's got a different one? In the process section, it needs to be moved over to the reaction.
Advantage.
Okay, so is it the entire thing, or you have a piece of it that you...
Thing,
so here's, I'm going to break this down. So this is where, partially, you're going to have to break some of these down. I'm going to say signaling the advantage with your arm, not just your voice. So that's one that we can break down into maybe a more manageable thing, which is the automatic arm out and advantage blue for whatever it is. That's one of those things that I think we might be able to more easily than overall advantage. And that's why some of these would have to be broken down to the next subsection. But what could you do? How would you all move this from process to reaction? The arm going out to signal it. What could you do to drill it, or to practice it, or to put that over in your reactionary brain?
Do it while you're watching games.
Sitting on your couch at night, watching games. I like that.
Watching games.
So I do it too. Like.
Watch games. Fair enough. That's
just
a great point.
Don't do it with the arm that has a beer in it.
I'm thinking in David's case, I think you've got to be careful not to force everything over. Because I'm seeing referees aspiring to play advantage every time. They're trying to play advantage when there clearly is no chance of advantage being gained. They try and play it.
Yeah, my,
it's
my
a good point.
My client is really based on the entire sort of subject is based on the interpreter, the referee's perspective at that one time. It's completely...
If I may real quick, this is one thing Ed Todd did really well. He would take advantage, and he'd break it down into 10 different manageable, measurable items. And only the last one is the magic of it, right? And so if you do the signaling right, and the secondary right, and the, you know, you have a, basically an equation you're going to use within that, you can measure and metric and change some of these individual items. The final decision of is it over or on or off is up to you. But if you can metric out a couple key things within that, it helps you to then better measure what you're doing. And so that's, I love it for that reason, for the level 2 and 3 that he had. He really made you measure things like, that's, I can't measure that. But he really put it down into smart goals, right? But I think that's one of those things where, no matter what it is, an advantage is one of those tough ones. We could maybe metric out a little more than we do right now.
I think it's usually called more quickly than let it go.
Yeah, so
the failure isn't calling it too quickly.
Sure.
There's the Sevens guideline probably is the best explanation of how to apply advantage I've found.
What sevens is actually said. So sevens is one pass away from the, you know, from danger. In clear spaces, it's all fine. Advantage over for the scrum.
So like,
but for penalty, it's a little bit different.
For like scrum, it was basically clear ball out with advantages. In other words, they have options and all that kind of stuff. And then penalty was a territorial gain, a significant territorial gain.
I talked to the number two.
Yeah,
so
basically the
significant.
I don't want to get too far off here. Give me a third example. No,
that's a tough
one. Yeah, give me a third example of one in process that needs to be moved to reactionary. Somebody else.
Squeeze ball at the high school level.
Squeeze ball at the high school level. Perfect one. This is a new one for us. So it's new for everybody. So it's in our process brain for every single one of us.
Yep.
How do we move it over to reactionary? Any ideas? Throw it out. There's no.
When we say processing, like processing, watching it happening, or processing, like is he about to do this?
I
think
we're
both.
You can anticipate it.
Because
I think maybe what I mean in the field is you have to stop and sort of process and think about it, what you're seeing and what you're doing, and then what you're going to do about it, because it's not. There's a little bit of guidance on what you should do, and I have to reprep, you know, tap into that. One. First is a turn of a scrum, then it's a penalty. I have to do all that kind of stuff. So right now it's a thoughtful process. How do we get it into, I know it's squeeze ball, I know exactly what I'm going to do after that.
Well, I started at the beginning of the pregame chat. I put it in there in the pregame chat in 19. Just prompt me to start remembering it. And then,
so you have some, say it out loud.
Yeah, say it out loud and say it to them, and I get them. I look at all the players when we're doing the boot check. I come up and I say, hey, real quick. And I don't bore them with a whole lot of things. I just sit there and say, remember, okay, no squeeze ball. And then,
first is visual, what else can you do to move that over?
So half of them, like, will sit there and go, what does that mean, sir? You know, and then we'll...
What else can you do up on the field?
So, I know it's Garyism, but I always think grenade with the tackle now. Grenade. Everybody better get away from the grenade. I know, right? Because, and then you can almost time it. Like, it's going to breathe, boom. You didn't go, you didn't release, and you can almost time it.
I hate to say it, but animal things and, you know, things like that are great. They make you remember.
Yeah, there it is sitting there, and everybody knows they need to get away from it. That monkey didn't move, that monkey, boom, it didn't mature quick enough, time's up.
Yeah. I love it. So let me ask you, did anybody have anything on the reactionary side that you would like to move to process? It's an issue you're having in your games that's not going well, that you currently have on your reaction side that should be on your process side. So I've not... Yeah.
It's actually an advantage for me. I think I'm just awarding advantage. Well, Mark would agree that I've thrown out the advantage arm where it's like should have been like either just let it breathe and run to anything or just blow it, you know.
That's a great one. A lot of us will just say advantage, but then nothing was even, the team never even turned over the ball. It's just an immediate whistle. So there never really was an advantage to be called there. That's a perfect one. How can we, well, so this is going to be a little more tough. How do you move something from reactionary process? So this is this one.
That I struggle that I don't have time to process, and that's the quick throw, right? Either you got to blow the whistle now and stop it, or it's gone. You just can't let it run and then think through it. All right, did someone else handle the ball, or you know, what's the lineup for?
So
you
I think
quick, you got
to.
It almost has to be
a
reaction.
For a second, I think you bring up a really good point. There are going to be things that have to be on the process side because we don't have the time, or on the reaction side, because we don't have the time to process it.
Yeah.
That's one that we're going to have to put over there, so we've got to find a way to do it.
Yeah.
That's actually a really great point. So there's going to be ones you have to put over there, and we don't have another option.
I was going to say,
go ahead.
I think phase 2 of that is then getting rid of bad anticipation. So if squeeze ball is a good example. If you're looking like, is he about to squeeze this ball? You might be missing something else that you're supposed to be reacting to, because now you're processing something that's not even happening because you're anticipating it.
That's a good point too. So you're reactionary, so that in this book, it's like your reactions could be wrong to something, right? So if you, they said if you flash up, if you flash up things about cleaning, and you put up the word S++P, everyone says soap. But then if you flash up something else about food, everyone says soup. And they're like, you are immediately cued by what has come before. And so how many of us see a squeeze ball, another squeeze ball, and that third ruck, we're looking for a squeeze ball, right? And so that's another thing to think about, which is, can you wipe the slate clean for each breakdown you're going into, each lineup you're going into, and each team we referee? How many of us have a team that gives us problems every time we referee them? I have them. So do you go into that game anticipating, yep, number three, you ready for your card yet? Or you want this now? So we got to think about that. Do I have preconceived notions that have prepped me in a certain way? So we're already running late.
Monday, I think we've got to keep over on the process side compared to reactions. The reaction we've got an outcome to. Process is a deliberate outcome. You've got to process that. Immediately you think, oh, it's an outcome. But what happens if it was deliberate outcome?
That's a great question. You're going to be so normalized by the, well, then it's a knock-on. But is it something different than what I'm normally seeing in a knock-on? Yeah.
And then you've got to think, what was he trying to do? Was the palm open? Was it coming down? Was it coming up? So don't try and force them all over. There's some that you've got to be able to look what was happening.
This is perfect. So this is a worksheet that I worked up in just a couple minutes. I would say put some thought into this. And I would love to hear your thoughts back, which is, watch some of your game video and see what you think about. I see myself and I know what I look like when I think. I look like an idiot. Because it slows me down. You see your brain starting, like the mud is setting in and you're walking through some sludge. It just doesn't look good. And so what do I need to move over into different categories? And I likely have some things in reaction shouldn't be there. They should be over in process. I need to think more about them.
But to add to that, as the game progresses, do you move some from the process to reaction?
Amazing question. And I think that's where you did a good job with it. Yeah. Did you set your stall or did you get your structure built? And you can maybe set those more in the reaction side.
And so the last quarter of the game.
Exactly. So by the end of the game, you don't have anything in the process side. Take the worksheet home. I'd love to hear your feedback on it. Map yourself out in the game. And maybe as you watch your own video, what can I move over? And I'd also like to hear, how did you move one from the other category back and forth? Did you drill it? Did you think about it? Did you just watch video? How do we get it moved around? Because I think we can all benefit from knowing how you did your thing so we can help move our own around. Alright. Thank you.
All right, guys, real quick, just before we go, we don't have a meeting in July. That's 2 months away. What we try to do is a summer social, so think about this as well. Lots of homework for you guys to do. Come to us with ideas in June, and we'll put it to a vote and get something organized for something to do in July as a get-together, okay?
Cool. We're going anywhere for a beer.
Whatever you like, Jim.
Okay, and then the whole summer.